friends and neighbors. Well, after more than a year and a half of uploading my ultimate recommendation book club analysis of To Kill a Mockingbird, I am finally doing the second part. So as many of you are probably aware, the author of To Kill a Mockingbird, Harper Lee, passed away recently, and it reminded me that I had never actually finished this particular analysis of her book, and I wanted to go ahead and finish that up for you and get on with the Ultimate Recommendation Book Club as I had originally done it. And so, for those of you who have not seen the first part, you can click here to watch that, and I would recommend that you do so. And for those of you who are wondering what in God's name an Ultimate Recommendation Book Club or Ultimate Recommendations are, and what even is this even, then I would recommend that you watch this video, which I posted yesterday. For those of you who subscribed to me recently, be aware that this is not going to be a typical Bandgeek 8408 review. These reviews are not nearly as polished as my regular reviews. I don't script them, and I don't worry too much about editing and making sure everything is polished and whatnot. I'll leave in the ums and the spaces and a lot of the misspeaks and all that sort of thing, because it's honestly just me talking about a book. It's just me kind of starting a conversation about something that I've read and looking more deeply into it and not being worried so much about polishing everything and making it sound right. Also, I said at the end of my first video of To Kill a Mockingbird that I was going to be splitting the book into three parts, and this would be covering chapters 11 through 21 for part 2 and the rest of the book for part 3, but I'm thinking about it more. I think I'm just going to do the rest of the book in this video. I'm just going to split the book into two like it is actually split into two, and so part 2 is going to start with chapter 12 and go through to the end of the book. That being said, let's get started. Now, in the last review, I talked a lot about how this book is often painted as a book about racism. The Tom Robinson trial is the plot that most people talk about when they talk about this book. But in a lot of ways, racism is, I wouldn't say a secondary theme, but it's one of many themes. It's one of many things that is talked about in this book, and the subject of racism isn't really talked about that much at all in the first 11 chapters in the first part of the book that we talked about last time. Rather, it talks about all forms of prejudice. The first chapter of part 2 has Jem and Scout going to Calperna's church. Calperna is their black housemaiden, basically, and she decides to take them to church one day, and so they get to be in a church with a number of other African Americans worshiping in a very, very different way from what they're used to. And one of the most striking things about this church, and I think one of the most touching things about this church, is that Calperna mentions that very, very few people in the church actually learned how to read. So they can't actually read the hymnals, they can't read the music, but they know the songs, they've learned the songs, and so there's someone up front who is leading them in the songs, and they're all just kind of singing them together with what they have. And I love hearing about congregations and worshipers who do that, who take what they're given, who take what they have, and just make the most of it. Beginning of the section also features a little bit more information about Scout's family, and particularly her Aunt Alexandria, Atticus Finch's sister, who has very old-fashioned and high-minded ideas. And Alexandria, like a lot of people, is also very concerned about Atticus taking on the case of Tom Robinson, and specifically defending Tom Robinson, who is a black man accused of raping a white girl. It's pretty much a foregone conclusion that he's gonna get convicted. Like, there's no question in anyone's mind that he did it, not because there's any particular evidence against him, but because it's easiest to accuse him. It's easiest to believe that he's the one who did it. Now, this plot really gets going in chapter 15 when there is talk that there might possibly be an attempt to lynch Tom Robinson while he is sitting in his jail cell. And so we see Atticus Finch sitting outside the jail waiting for this lynch mob to appear and basically being, apparently, we find out later that he's not, but apparently the only thing standing between Tom Robinson and this group of angry citizens of Maycomb who want to kill him. It's interesting to me that the only time that we actually see Atticus get nervous is when he realizes that his kids are in danger too. And it's also very striking that one of the people who is a part of this lynch mob is a Cunningham, who, as we talked about in the first part of this review, are looked at as the poor people, the ones who don't have a lot of money, who live on the outskirts, the edges of town, who pay what they can, but who just don't have a lot to give. And I think it's very important for Scout to point out Mr. Cunningham being there, because Mr. Cunningham is also a victim of prejudice because of his situation, specifically his financial situation. He's a victim of prejudice too, and yet he still has prejudice. That doesn't exempt him from having prejudices of his own, as we also found out at the end of part one with Mrs. DuBose. Just because a group is prejudiced against does not mean that they do not also have prejudice. Now, six chapters are devoted to the case of Tom Robinson. And this is another instance where the genius of putting the narration from the point of view of Scout and having it be both from the point of view of Scout the child, but also from the point of view of Scout the adult, looking back on her childhood self, and having that combined narration really, really works in the story's favor, because Scout is there as an innocent child looking at all of this and actually making a fair judgment on the case, saying, well, yeah, no, he obviously didn't do it. Atticus made a good case here. And yet also having the mature perspective of looking back on this case as an adult and understanding, like, the real ramifications of what all was happening. And we hear about this case from a bunch of different perspectives. We hear about it from the town sheriff, who, you know, presumably has a fairly objective perspective. Here are the facts, here's what happened, etc. We hear about it from Mr. Ewell, the father, who is incredibly racist. We hear about it from the very, very simple-minded Mayella, and of course we hear about it from Tom Robinson himself. So a lot of different perspectives coming through here, and, you know, kind of Rashomon-like, not all of them are necessarily factual. You get the feeling that all of these are editorialized in some way. They're all looking at it from a different perspective, and none of them is necessarily the truth. But Atticus still manages to make a very compelling argument in favor of Tom Robinson's innocence, which is what this whole case is supposed to be about. And I think if you look at that argument very, very carefully, then what we find out later when, you know, a lot of people read Go Set a Watchman, what we found out about Atticus later about him, you know, actually being a racist, that makes more sense when you read it in that way. It's not that his personality fundamentally changed. It's not that he just suddenly became a racist overnight. He always held a lot of those beliefs because he is a product of his environment. The difference is he was still rational enough and reasonable enough to understand that people still needed to make decisions based on evidence and facts and based solely on the law and not based on their emotions. Which still makes him a remarkable character in that time period, which was a very emotionally charged time period, especially with regards to racism. And this is a very emotionally charged story, not just because of the race aspect, but also because it involves a rape. It involves sexual assault. And so there's a lot of emotions running high for a lot of different reasons. So it's very easy to get caught up in the emotional turmoil. And once again, just like with the lynch mob and just like with a lot of other instances in this book, Atticus Finch stands as the cool, calm pillar of reason that he is. And is able to see things clearly and is able to see beyond his own prejudices and, you know, try to do his best to defend this man who he honestly doesn't believe has done anything wrong. Now, it is interesting to me that in the original draft of this novel, which is essentially what Go Set a Watchman is, and this is something that I noticed when I was reading Go Set a Watchman, I didn't really understand until I learned a little bit more about it, but in the original draft, Tom Robinson was acquitted. Like, she had Tom Robinson cleared of his crime due to Atticus Finch's argument. And that, I think, would have been a very, very unrealistic perception of what would actually have happened in that time. I think what we see in To Kill a Mockingbird, where Tom Robinson is declared to be guilty of this crime, in spite of Atticus Finch's argument and in spite of his rational reasoning, and in spite of the respect that he has in the community as a strong lawyer and a strong advocate of the law, I still think that he would have been found guilty. And again, what's interesting about this moment when the verdict comes down and it comes down as guilty is that the person who is really, really fundamentally affected by it is Jem more than Scout. Even though Scout's the one telling the story, it's Jem who's really coming to this realization, because Jem was so sure, oh, he's going to be found innocent. There's no question, he's going to be found innocent. And Scout really didn't seem to have an opinion about it one way or the other. But Jem was the one saying, oh, you just watch. They're going to find him innocent. Atticus did it. It's in the bag. And then to find out that, no, they actually did declare him guilty, he's just crestfallen, and he is absolutely devastated, and this is Jem really losing his innocence and his sort of very high idealism of the world, basically looking and saying, no, people really can do that, and they really can find him guilty based on no sort of evidence at all. That really is the way the world works sometimes. And I think we even see that throughout the rest of the story, where Jem is the one observing a lot of the stuff that happens to Atticus after all this, Jem more than Scout, and then Jem relays it to Scout. We really see Jem's growing up, and we see Jem's character development, but we see it, again, through Scout's eyes. And Scout's affected by it, too. I'm not saying that she's not. Like, she also sees the unfairness of it. She was also sure that he was going to be found innocent, and then was disillusioned by all that. But Scout is also, I think, a little bit more resilient. She's still developing, she's still a child, and so I think she's a little bit more easily able to handle this. Oh, well, okay, he was found guilty. And again, where Scout's real development comes is in, you know, Go Set a Watchman, which I'll probably do a separate review of to talk about that. But yeah, that's really where Scout's sort of big disillusionment moment comes, and not so much with the verdict of Tom Robinson here. And then after the verdict, there's still another 10 chapters in the book, and there's still a lot that still needs to happen. Remember, this book was originally... The premise of this book was, this is how Jem broke his arm. Well, Jem hasn't broken his arm yet, and we're still not really sure how he's going to do that. But there's still 10 chapters left in the book. There's still some things to wrap up, even though the verdict has been handed down and all of this has come to pass. And the book basically goes back to what it was before. So in the first part of the book, it was basically a series of vignettes. There was a kind of a through line. There were, you know, plot elements that kept coming back, like Tom Robinson and Boo Radley and all that sort of thing. But it was, in many ways, a series of vignettes, a series of separate memories, which all kind of related to being part of Scout's childhood. And it kind of goes back to that. We hear some more kind of unrelated stories and things that, again, relate to prejudice, like the missionary circle and Scout, you know, trying to act like a lady and seeing all this stuff going on among the women of Maycomb and all of this, and, you know, Mr. Ewell spitting on Atticus and all this sort of thing. But it's all kind of with that overtone of what has transpired with Tom Robinson. Like, you still get the sense that things have fundamentally changed for Scout and for Jem, and in some ways for Atticus, too. You get the feeling that there has been that fundamental change, even though, in a way, we've returned to the status quo. We've returned to the way that things were with just kind of this series of memories. And even as we're getting into the setup for the climax and the end of the novel with Jem finally breaking his arm, even as we get into that, it's still set up like, and then we had Halloween, and I had to dress up as a ham in this skit and all this sort of thing. And it's still set up as, oh, here's some more memories from my childhood. Not really focusing in on what happened with Tom Robinson, like, you know, basically saying, we moved past that. We moved on, more things happened, here are some more memories of my childhood. But then it all comes together as we have Mr. Ewell coming after Scout and Jem breaking his arm, trying to fight him off and all this sort of thing. And then finally, at the very end of the novel, after he's been pretty much forgotten about, like, this is what really brought it home for me. Boo Radley hasn't been mentioned since like chapter 14, I don't think. It's been pretty much forgotten about. There's been no mention of him. He hasn't been a fixture. You know, we've been distracted by this Tom Robinson story. And then all of a sudden, there he is. He's back. And you get the feeling that because of the relationship that occurred between the kids and Boo Radley in the beginning of the story, in part one of the story, and kind of the back and forth that they had with the, you know, putting the gifts in the tree knot and all that sort of thing, you get the feeling that that's why he made the effort to come out of his house, to break out of being a recluse, and to try to save these children. And it's also interesting to me to see Atticus Finch in a very, very moral dilemma here, because here you have Mr. Ewell, who has died as a result of this fight. And it's hard to say, you know, did he fall on his own knife? Was he stabbed by Boo Radley? Was he stabbed by Jem? Atticus has to face up to the fact that even though it's not legal necessarily, even though it's not according to the law. Everything that he's argued for his entire life, we have to do things according to the law, we have to, you know, all this sort of thing. And even though it's not, the morally right thing to do is to just let it be and to say, Mr. Ewell fell on his own knife. That's what we're gonna say. No matter what the evidence is to the contrary, that's what we're going to say because that's the right path to take. And it's the exact same thing as the Tom Robinson case. And I think that's what Atticus finds so haunting, is that even though, you know, according to the law and according to the evidence, Tom Robinson didn't rape this girl, we're still going to say that he did because that's what's easiest for everybody. It's the same rationale. We're going to say that Mr. Ewell fell on his own knife, even though, you know, who knows if he did or not, but we're going to say that because that's what's easiest for everybody. And I think Atticus really struggles with this. Is this really the morally right thing to do? And it is kind of a double standard because they're basically dismissing Mr. Ewell in the same way that they dismissed Tom Robinson. Well, no one's going to care if he's gone. Nobody cares because he's a horrible person. He's, you know, this awful bigot who tried to kill Atticus Finch's kids because he said all these horrible things about him. It's the same rationale. And yet, when you look at it, it does seem to be the morally right path to take. And so for as much as people criticize To Kill a Mockingbird and saying that it's too black and white, it's too simplistic, all this sort of thing, first of all, it's from the point of view of a little kid, so of course it is. But second of all, if you really read deeply into it, you do find some really morally gray things that they address. And again, they're addressing them from the point of view of a child, so, you know, there's still kind of a black and white stigma to it. But this is really a morally gray area because this is a real double standard and a real struggle for Atticus to try to overcome what he should do about this. And then, of course, you have wrapping things up with Boo Radley. And he really is kind of at the center of this because, you know, even setting aside the thing with his children and all that sort of thing, Boo Radley deserves to be left alone. And that's kind of the point that they make after all this. You know, Boo Radley is not a bad person. He hasn't done anything wrong. And he was, you know, he shouldn't be punished for stepping out of his shell and trying to help. And that's basically what they would be doing if they dragged him into all of this, regardless of whether, you know, he actually did anything wrong in that case. And here at the end of the novel, when Scout finally realizes what her father has been talking about all this time, about standing in someone else's shoes, and she finally gets this, you know, very broad, and, you know, it's, she's a child, it's very brief, it's not like it's a life-changing, I mean, it is a life-changing thing to a certain extent, but it's not like it's this huge, major thing that that she takes with her for the rest of her life. It's a very brief, I can see the world from all these different perspectives, and I think that's something that we've all kind of experienced sometimes. And again, it's usually very brief, it's usually just kind of a, oh, I understand the world for a few seconds, and then you go back to being a part of the world and not really being above it. But I think that's described at the end of the novel really, really incredibly well. And I think that really is, it drives home the whole point of this book, which is to point out all of these different prejudices that we have, but to encourage us that despite those prejudices, which are going to exist regardless of, you know, how intelligent we might consider ourselves to be, in spite of all that, to honestly try to empathize with people who are different than we are, and to honestly try to put ourselves in their shoes, to imagine them complexly, as John Green later said in Paper Towns, and to just really understand how they might be seeing the world and how that might be different from us, and how that's okay. So like I said in the first video, every time I read this book, I find something new to love about it, and I really do feel like I fell in love with this book all over again just reading it. And I did read Go Set a Watchman, and I do have a separate review of that and separate thoughts on that book, and I'll probably upload a video about that at some point soon as well. But as for To Kill a Mockingbird, I still consider it an ultimate recommendation. It's still going to be a part of my 5 ultimate recommendation books. I would love to hear what you all think of To Kill a Mockingbird and what you all think of what's been said here, and whatever thoughts that you might have, please leave those in the comments. And the next book on the Ultimate Recommendation Book Club is going to be The 5 People You Meet in Heaven by Mitch Albom. It's not nearly as religious as it sounds, don't worry. This book, by the way, is the only book on my wife's ultimate recommendation list. It's the only book that she considers an ultimate recommendation because she thinks there should only be one ultimate recommendation, and she's not wrong, but I have 5, so
What are you gonna do?
Five People You Meet in Heaven is so short that I'm probably just gonna do it all in one video. I'm not gonna try to split it up into parts. I'm just gonna do the whole thing at once. So go ahead and read it. It's a short read, it's a fast read, and that will be the next book in the book club whenever I decide to actually do that, which might be a couple years from now. So until then, happy reading. For those of you who subscribed recently, thank you for walking in front of the light show. Shadow in front of the... Okay. First video on Tamila Cockingbird.